about a few streams ago, I had the pleasure to commend for braveries folks that registered for this remote Proctor stuff, and I justified my commandment because usually whenever you have something for the first time, you usually have unsettled things, and you have few things which can go wrong, and few things which are kind of unsettled. But at the time of my kind of position, statement of position on this, there were no details available. It was just that announcement, right? Thank you for sharing with me this webinar presentation, which took place and provided the room for some details about the specifics of the remote Proctor at CBLE. I think it was invited only. I didn't attend personally. I think only the people who registered were invited to attend. So there were some details, and some details may have frustrated some people simply because and as I said before, whenever you have something which is being experimented with, number one, you have a wide room for error. And on top of whatever you have to do already with this exam, as far as remembering all the materials, bringing all the outlines, and having to deal with the timing, you have another thing to worry about, which is kind of like uncharted territory of proctored remote CBLE. So some things since you share with me, I thought I just kind of go over something that some things that were detailed out as kind of interesting, to say it politely. Also, it goes to the idea of the psychology of the proctors, because whenever you have exam which is supposed to be a controlled environment, if you outsource it into the space which is outside of your control, physically speaking, then the digital methodology of control probably goes up. And of course there is insecurity, and of course there is room for new rules. Now, the question comes when you have something new, the rules are being formed. And because the rooms are being formed, what if there is no written procedure for having something which no one thought of? There are two methods of dealing with it, basically. One is presumption that everything which is not written, it is allowed. And then there are another school of thought, if you will, is a presumption that everything which is not written is denied. So unless it's written, it is prohibited. So my understanding of proctors, the people who will be babysitting you throughout the exam, whether you show up or whether you are not, you are taking it home, will be I think it will be the position that there will be presumption of denial. In other words, if it's not written, it is prohibited. So the level of scrutiny goes up, especially if you are living, if you are outsourcing the exam into your own quarters. So let's take a look at some of this stuff, because I think they're interesting. So so they said that it has to be in a room, and they define the room as having four walls. So because of the again, you have individuals coming, and those questions, they do not show up just because there is out of the blue. Someone must have brought them up, and I'm not even sure if it comes from examinees or not, but maybe it's FAQs, frequently asked questions. But can the room have windows? Well, usually I'm not sure if you are what your building code is, but if in New York City, if you are living in a residential dwelling, you're required by code to have at least one window. There are exceptions for basements, and there are various rules, but pretty much that's the law. And I think there is a separate code, like we learn the code, right, of federal regulations, where we have a building code, and then there is a fire code, which requires pretty much the same. Then there is a question, okay, so obviously no one thought, can the room have doors or not? But pretty much it's a given. So then there is a question, are the glass doors appropriate? I'm not sure where that came from, but they pretty much said, yeah, so the glass door, I guess the way it's made also is very important. And then take a look at the question number five. The question number five is that specific advantage that I was telling about during my last comments on the remote exam, and that is writing on the wall. Whenever you have, I think I told you, if you recall a few streams back, when I was preparing for my bar exam, I would have a criminal law corner, family law corner, the New York law, the federal law. I would know exactly where to look in order for me to review. Now, if I was able to leave all those notes and go and revisit them during the exam, that would be great. But the problem is that here's what they say. So listen, they say the proctors are very uptight individuals, if you read between the lines, and they say, please keep in mind that it might be distracting to have the proctor continuously check your testing environment. So in other words, you can face constant distractions by a proctor requiring you to pretty much do certain things. So this is kind of kills the point of the this whole check. And on top of that, what I would suggest, if you have a small text, I would prefer to get up, check the statute regulation on my wall and come back. Now what they're saying is it has to be, later on they say you have to stay in your seat because you have to be visible at your camera, by your camera all the time. That's number six. So you cannot leave the frame to look at the reference material. This is another thing. Forget about even going to check out your writing on the wall. What you have is you have a situation where, let's say I bring a book, and let's say there is a frame, and I'm going to, I have it about arm's length, the book with me. So I'm getting the book, I'm already out of the frame. And now I came back, I have the book. Now the proctor is going to require me to maybe make a 360 review or whatever. So that's losing the precious time. So that's another disadvantage. And then there is something I just totally don't understand. Why would someone would even bring it up? But then again, we live in a world of I guess, social progress. So the question is, did anybody register for home exam? I'm not. If someone wants to come forward, I'll leave it up to them. But we had people register, yes. So smoke and regular cigarette. Yes, no electronic cigarettes. So in other words, they brought up a question of smoking, and I mean it wouldn't even occur to my mind of smoking during the exam, because number one, just think about this. You're having a cigarette. That means you probably need to have an ashtray. That also probably means you have to have a lighter. That also probably means that you have to have a cigarette pack lying somewhere around. But then at a later place, I cannot see it right now, but they say that the desk must be clear except for the paper, the reference material, and all the other stuff. And then I had a comment about this electronic cigarettes. It's kind of like electronic calculator, because or iPad. So it is equivalent to that type of stuff. So that's where electronic comes from. I mean, after looking all this stuff, I wouldn't be surprised if someone would say, "Oh yes, Svetlana, yes." So yeah, that the door pull, the glass door. You probably need to surround yourself with a glass door, Svetlana. Okay, but the thing about the cigarettes is, the next probably question would be, I wouldn't even be surprised, are the marijuana joints allowed to be smoked? The answer, yeah, this is very simple. So let's say you live in a state like Washington State, where recreational use of marijuana is permitted. So we have one of recreational users during the exam would like to light up a joint. I'm not talking about the CBD stuff, which are gaining popularity out there. What would be the proper response? Of course, no, because under the federal law, which customs, U.S. Customs and Border Protection enforces, the cannabis substances that contain cannabis and THC, they are considered to be they are on a controlled substances list and therefore illegal unless you have special permit, like let's say you are the research facility or something like that. That contradicts and goes head to head with the state law. And many recreational users from Washington State, whenever they travel, and Washington State is right on the borderline of Canada, whenever they travel to visit the Canada, they find themselves surprised that their marijuana gets dispossessed by U.S. Customs. They get honestly surprised. This was documented. There is a show, I think it's called Border Patrol or something like that, run by either Showtime or HBO. So what they've done is they have cameraman implants within the CBP teams. And they had a whole series about it in several seasons, I think. You may find it interesting to see various stuff they do, including stuff which are later to be found illegal, such as having a phone. If you have a phone, for example, let's say you come in and to the border, right? So you have a phone, and CBP officer, they say, okay, let me see that phone. All right, what's your password? And they start looking through your pictures, right? They start looking through your stuff. And they justify it to the Supreme Court case back in the day. It was like 1960s, I think. It may go beyond that, but pretty much we have a Fourth Amendment, right, which prescribes the search and seizures, which are unreasonable. But pretty much the Fourth Amendment is suspended at the border. So this is something that they justify. But there was an outcry saying that, listen, there is too much, it's too much of an invasion of privacy, so we need to do something about it. So the customs came up with this particular memorandum saying that the only time you can actually check someone's phone is in the presence of the supervisor. In other words, you have to have a superior officer standing there and making sure that the desk officer is doing what it's supposed to and not exceeding what's not, because it's the cell phones nowadays, they contain just too much information, right? All right, so so electronic cigarettes, that was a weird part. Something else I found interesting, right behind me. So when I had, when I took my exam, I did have the stuff behind me, simply because there was no room. I had, so I brought, I had CFR, I laid down CFR, and they were all in the binders. So I brought put CFR on my left, I put HTS on my right, and I had my desk. And sometimes when I was done with, let's say, part one of CFR, I would just put it behind me, and then I would reach it and I would take it up. It's just convenient because it creates, it gives you more space in the limited space that you have. Now they bring it to question because they consider this to be a violation. So another restriction. All right, bathroom breaks. Now that's interesting because here they expand the definition of bathroom breaks, because usually in an old environment, bathroom break was exactly what it meant. You get up, you go take care of your business, and you come back and you continue the exam. Here they say the bathroom break is actually the term of art. It can be any reason, such as the kids or something urgent. They say, yeah, it's limited to 10 minutes each, so you can take 20 minutes out. So that was something interesting. I didn't think they would give that up, but they decided to do that. So then the new change, they used to say cell phones are allowed, cell phones are not allowed. And let me see. Then there is this handheld mirror. Mirror, mirror on the wall. who is the most beautiful of all? Of course, the most beautiful person is the proctor in this case, because they are the ones who are controlling, having a tight control of your environment. So, so yes, there is a handheld mirror. Of course, they don't specify the size, so it can be minor or not minor, but pretty much those are the things which you will be subjected to. Therefore, my comments about the one being a brave person and my comments about me being a weak link in this case, I would not go for it, kind of substantiate into this couple of documents. All right, so that's for, and of course this stuff doesn't apply if you go in person, because this would be something which is stuff which I think you will be in a controlled environment, and this will be less kind of like a less risky. The only other thing that I want to mention about the materials, reference materials. So please take a look at this particular statement right there. I think it's also on Pearson review website, but for some reason last time I checked their website was down, just like my website was down. So something weird is going on. But anyway, so basically, what I'm going to ask you to do is, when you, for those of you who are going physically, print this page out, bring this in, because the way this is written is anything, if you're having a suitcase and it exceeds those dimensions, it will not be allowed. So you may have some stickler for details that says, okay, those dimensions are exceeded. You probably all been through the airports, and you know that if you fly, for example, one airline, they have strict enforcement rules. And if it goes over by like 1 or 2 inches, that's it. They're going to make you check it in into the baggage. It can be the hand carry, you know, the bags. So, but if you take the other airline, they're like, okay, fine, well, just don't do it next time. Keep on going. So it really depends on a proctor, because proctors are people too. But in case you get one of those strict ones, you need to have that printout available. Especially make sure you have the official link. Simply because if you have someone who says, okay, you are not allowed to, okay, if you bring in the rolling crate, that's a different story. But the suitcase that exceeds these dimensions, sometimes if you stick all the stuff in your suitcase, it may exceed those dimensions. So just take it out of the suitcase and reduce the dimensions of the suitcase and keep it in the hands. There is no policy in there that says that I cannot show up with all my stuff in the hands. So just a good point, because people are people, and it's much easier to you give them the reason, give them the official reason of why you're being correct, as opposed to being someone who is being argumentative. I do not know if I said my story earlier. Whenever I go to the New York Supreme Court in which is located in Queens County, with attorney pass, I can go without security check, but sometimes I forget it, don't bring it. Plus, the place is empty anyway, so I go through the security, and usually as a part of my briefcase, I have a little Canon camera, which is not just a regular old school camera, and I use that to sometimes to take pictures of the documents. It's just helpful stuff to carry around. So the policy of that court, I believe to this day, it's been a while since I visited that place. It's been pre-COVID times, but the policy was this: he would take my camera out, but then the next guy who has a cell phone, which has even a better camera, I'm talking about like the iPhone, he would let them in. So my question, my issue is this: so the security guy knows, and I know that this guy has a better camera. And at the same time, the security guy also knows that there are rules, and sometimes those rules are written in place, and it's better to stick to them because this is his job. So it's err on the side of caution, in other words. So does it make sense to do that? Probably, if you ask him, no. But he is not there to make sense. He says, I'm just a simple worker here. I just work here, all right? So that would be the answer. I just work here. And somewhere in those Q&A, I think, like a last question, is, are those proctors actually CBP employees? In other words, do they work for the federal government or not? And I think that was a good question, because the answer is no. They're just the regular employees for hire. Maybe they can be even treated as independent contractors. So this is something which puts them in a less secure position than government employees, because for government employees, it's not as easy to discharge the government employee as it would be the private sector employee. So again, sometimes you walk in or you get addressed by through the camera, but basically you may think some requirement is ridiculous. It's not really the good idea to say, okay, this is ridiculous. The rules are out there. If you want to challenge them, or you want to go with interpretation, like, okay, this is not there, so I can do that. And I'm talking about the most essential stuff. I'm not talking about smoking. I'm talking about the actual materials. If your materials exceed and you need them to be successful, then definitely there is a good reason to stand your ground. But if there is something which will be mere inconvenience, such as, like I said, smoking cigarettes, electronic versus regular ones, I don't think this is something which should be that important, even for smokers, because all smokers can go without smoking for some time fine. Yes, it's inconvenient, but it's not fatal. So fatal meaning not health wise, but examination wise.